All right. Hello, everybody. It's great to be back and announce the start of our first spring practice here at Nebraska. We're really looking forward to it. It is, I think one of the great times of preparation for a team for a season is obviously spring practice. And I kind of divide the year into like really four parts: the off-season program early when you get started in January, and then building up to what you're going to do here, and then the off-season program that continues in the summertime, which is a little bit different, and then you get into fall camp to put an exclamation point on your preparation for the year, and then you start playing games. So it's a great time of year. I think the kids have done a great job in the off-season program with a new staff involved. I think the emphasis and the importance of spring practice is pretty obvious here, with new terminology, some new stuff football-wise, just kind of a lot of newness for the players involved. These things, the focus always has to go to the team and the development of the players. So, in the end, we've got to make this as comfortable for them as possible in a way that they can learn so they can play. That's always a big issue in teaching, really, is that we have a fairly complicated game here that has to be made to seem simple so that they can go play like crazy. In spring practice, we have plenty to do. We want to establish some values as to what we have, what we want to have in a program, just the way we are, and we want to establish some ways that we practice and what's important about practice and practice attitude, actions, and behaviors, and then we want to improve individual skills and develop skills through drills, and then we want to get teams ready, offensive teams ready, defensive teams ready, special teams ready, all those parts. So we've got a lot to do, more to do than normal. When you've been at a place and had a program, you can start on the first day of spring practice and put the ball down and hopefully run some plays that look like football. Well, I hope that we can get to that fast, obviously. So there's a lot going on, but it's a real exciting time. I always look at it, the spring of the year, it's a dawn of a new day. And so the formation of the team, all the stuff that we get to do, I mean, this is what we really like about this job, is going to work with football players on a football field. And I guess the weather's supposed to be good. Right now we're counting on practicing outdoors. So I'll open it up from there to questions. That's a great question. I don't know if you all heard it. How are we planning on structuring practice so we get a look at all the guys? And I have actually been going back and forth in my mind on this for a while, especially as I started watching and was back to watch more of the off-season program. And I looked at about 120 guys out there, and I've never had that many in spring practice before. The numbers that we have been used to are right around 75-80, and so I haven't actually introduced this to the whole team yet, but what we're going to do, and so it will affect your start times too, probably a little bit, and I've only really got this set up for a practice to see how it goes, but we're gonna practice. We've divided the team into two teams. And we're going to have two practices. Saturday, I call one team red, and we really have mixed. We have team red and team white, and we're going. And there's a mixture of on both teams of younger or inexperienced players and experienced players. Both team red and team white will have both. But we'll end up. for instance, when we go individual period, instead of Keith Williams, our receiver coach, working with 18 guys at one time in individual period, he'll work with 9. And that group will practice for an hour plus. The first team that will practice will be Team Red. And then at the end of that practice, the other team will be stretching. Then they'll both get together, and we'll teach our first phase of special teams, which will involve field goal and field goal block. That will be our first day of special teams. And then Team Red will be done after that. They'll go in. Team White will really duplicate what was already done with Team Red. So the people that are going to be out there the longest will be the coaches. And that will be fun, actually. And I think this is simply best for the players, the opportunity to get coached, get some repetitions. I did not want to have a team period where 22 guys were competing or playing and 100 guys were watching. That didn't sound too good to me. So we worked out this, and if this will work, you know, it'll be good for Saturday because there's no school, you know, so I've got to fit this into Monday, Wednesday, Friday a little bit. And I think we can, because we don't practice every day, so I think we can have ample meeting time to get it done. Because what we'll do for Saturday is we will have our pre-practice meeting on Friday afternoon, and then we'll just show up Saturday morning and start into this schedule. We'll have breakfast and get taped, and Team Red will go. So I don't have that time. It's about – is Hillary still here? Hillary, are you back there? What time was that first – you remember that first practice time on Saturday? 10, and then that team will be practicing at 10, and then the Team White will stretch at 11. So that's how it'll overlap from there. I've never done this. So
where did you get this idea from, or this format from?
I just thought of it. I should have said somewhere else, just in case I can blame somebody else. But it just came from that idea, just what I said. I just thought, gosh, you know, we're going to run a team period, and there's going to be 22 guys playing, and there's going to be 100 guys, you know. That's workable during the season because you have scout teams running other teams' plays, so there's more guys really participating. You basically have multiple team periods going. Spring practice is a lot of interaction against each other, and especially for us right now in just teaching what we're doing. I just don't like standing around. It's a little bit of, you know, we're just gonna try to give guys opportunity. The other good thing about this, I think, is we will learn more about the players. We will find more guys that, you know, that's kind of what we have to do, is find how many guys can we get ready to play in the games. That's it. Whether it's offensive lineman or a guy that might run down in a kickoff, we've got to look through this group and see how many guys we can find that might be able to do that. And the only way to do that is to give them an opportunity. So this is the best way I've thought to do it at this point. That could be pretty fluid as we go. So we'll give it a go. I don't think we'll do it the whole spring. I'd like to do it up to spring break, which would mean 2 weeks of practice, 7 practices. Oh, yeah, because, you know, the rules involve how many hours they are actually participating. So the practices for the players, frankly, aren't as long as they would be if it was one practice for everybody. You know, they'll probably almost take an hour off of their time on the field.
So your 20-hour time doesn't start until you're on the field for each play.
Yeah, that's right. So the Team White deal will start at 11 o'clock, basically. It's easy. That part of it will be easy.
Is that how you will divide the teams for the red-white scrimmage, or how do you get
that? Haven't gotten that far yet. Again, this is the spring game, or our scrimmages will be, I think, less complicated than I'm used to because of the numbers of players that we have. And that will be good, but I really you know, I don't want to go too far ahead until I look at how this works, and we'll adjust, because we can always go back to the original format, but our other option on the thing is to go back-to-back in practice, you know, have a team practicing that way, team practicing that way. We could do that. I've done that before, and I find that hard coaching, you know, to really pay attention. So there's, I'm sure, every format you look at has some positives and negatives. And really, the trump card here is this, I think, is best for the players. So.
How much live scrimmaging do you want to do this spring?
You know, I haven't outlined all of that yet. Normally what we've done is, you know, about every third practice have some live stuff after we get pads on. You know, and it might be 10 minutes. You guys are going to get eight plays. You guys are going to get five plays. And we just go. We kind of build into it. I don't normally just wait and then have a 120-play scrimmage all of a sudden. We'll just take some periods and say, okay, this is full speed. The thin numbers at linebacker impacted the whole idea of what I'm talking about. And frankly, we don't have enough really depth at center to necessarily do this either. But we will train some other guys. Cav's always been good at that. You know, we'll train some other guys. He's pretty good at moving people around in the line. You know, so you know, if a guy can learn the concepts of what we're doing, then he becomes adjustable. We've had some of our very best players in history play every position on the line. So we'll have to adjust at center, and we'll have to adjust at linebacker, but I think there's enough guys to do it. How are we going to handle the quarterback situation is the question, and does Tommy's experience lend into this, how we're going to handle it itself. So, and yes, Tommy's going to take the snaps. He's going to be on the team red. He's going to take the first snaps. You know, all the guys that have played and started, those guys are going to be the ones that do that. I think that even if we weren't new, even if we were starting fresh, I think it's important for every player to know they have an opportunity to win a job. So, but you have to start somewhere. This is a good place to start. To me, these guys have earned those spots in this program for Tommy to be able to take the first snap and start practicing. And I think we owe it to every player to evaluate it closely as we go and make sure that they are being coached and developed and how much they grow and be able to make a good determination if somebody does indeed win a job down the road. I think that the competition can make everybody rise up. I think the more that we develop the whole team, the more competition there is, the more the team can grow. We want to grow every individual because I think it collectively then we'll be a better team. It's just pretty obvious that we can do that. So I think, and guys have a better tendency to grow when they know they have opportunity. So we got to have an environment where guys can feel great about learning, feel great about their opportunity. They're not all going to get, obviously, good news, but we want them to at least know that they're going to get a chance. And I think in doing that, we'll find more players, develop more players. And the quarterback deal after that, just to finish the answer to the quarterbacks, is experience is a big, big factor for every player. Guys that have played in games have an advantage because there's nothing like playing in the games. That is multiplied by some degree for the quarterback. There's nothing like playing in the games for a quarterback. So that experience is good. Our job now is to give the other guys who haven't played very much in the games ample opportunity to progress and compete. And, you know, then we'll have to make a judgment as we go as to where that all sits. But that's how it looks. So this is another possibly good way to get all those quarterbacks, there's six of them. So you have one practice, it's hard to get anybody enough turns. It's going to be hard anyway with two practices to get them enough. But we're going to get more turns with the quarterbacks, and they'll get an opportunity to show what they can do. Our initial impression of the crop of running backs is that it looks like a good group of athletes. There's a variety of size there, and it looks like a variety of different kinds of abilities. Backs are unique as to their style and what they bring to the table, and that's probably all I'll say about it until I get to watch them play. It just looks like working out. It's a good group of athletes. He is ready. We talked about that just minutes ago, and he has been cleared.
Hey, Mike, going back to the quarterbacks, if Tommy's going to kind of go into it as the guy that you put out there first, is there a pecking order behind him at this point?
Is there a pecking order after Tommy at this point if he's going to go in taking the first snaps? Not really. Not really. That's where we have to provide opportunity for guys to play. You know, I think that's really all new to us because, you know, there's not that much film to study to necessarily say we could make a good judgment. I don't want to make anything up about who should be the next guy at this point when we really can't watch them on film too much, and so we just haven't got to see them. The only thing for us to do is to watch them. Coach him, and then watch him practice.
Can you address the importance of having a quarterback's coach, something that hasn't been around here for a while?
Well, I really think that having Danny Langsdorf be our quarterback coach is very, very positive. He's, you know, just proven through the years with the number of guys he's worked with at our place at Oregon State, and you know, and what he has done in the NFL. I think that basically having that go-to guy for the quarterbacks, even during the day when they want to come up and watch a little more film or talk, have that guy designated is really important to me on the staff. Now, I think that you know, we sacrifice in some areas on our staff to have a full-time special teams coach of one of the nine coaches. That's what Bruce Reed does, you know. But to me, that is also a good decision because Bruce Reed coaches six teams. You know, he coaches field goal block, punt, punt return, kickoff return. He touches lots of guys on the team. So, and I know that he knows that's his number one job. He's not coaching the tight ends for a while and then thinking, well, I got to do the kickoff return now. That's it. So I like that. I also like that about quarterback, Dale. This guy, you know, it's obviously a very, very key position in the success of a football team, how that guy performs. So having that relationship, having that guy available, having that one-on-one technique work all the time, I think is absolutely necessary. You know, probably during the early part of practice, you'd see me in individual time, probably watching the quarterbacks, and then probably watching a lot of the throwing taking place between when the quarterback starts throwing to the receiver. You know, see if we can beat the air. If you can drop back and throw the ball to a receiver, and there's no rush and no coverage, that's a starting point. So that's probably, and then we're going to actually do a little bit more interaction, offense against defense, than I've done before, just because I think the question about defense, that's the best way for me to see all the guys together, and it is also offensively, you can go down there and you can run plays, you can throw the ball, you can do a lot against air and just repeat plays, repeat patterns. And, you know, defensively you need usually somebody to react to. So we're trying to combine both. We're going to give, you know, the offense some individual time, and then we're going to do some interaction with pass skeleton. And so I'll be involved with both groups there. And then when we go team, obviously, we'll get – so that's how we kind of blend it. Yeah. Well, I think that there's what do we plan to do defensive end with Randy Gregory being gone, and where do we go from there? I think that I'm going to be able to better answer that question as I look at this team. You know, I think it's a great point. Many times you're looking at that, always looking for really that one guy that can win on a pass rush, and it, you know, it can come from different areas. In this team, I think it could come from the tackles. These tackles are pretty good players. We have had in our history, we've had, when we had Victor Butler or a guy like Scotty Crichton at end, those were featured pass rushers. Everybody else complimented them. They were going to win one-on-one. The other guys had to, like I said, compliment them and be in good position. We also had Stephen Paya, and we've got guys like that, I think, at defensive tackle that would win in there against the three technique. So, you know, and I'm not going to be able to really, until we practice and look at it and see how it fits together and who can be that featured third down pass rusher and win like that, we'll just have to watch spring practice. And then it's just like everything. Hopefully we're going to learn more and more about these guys, take their abilities and enhance them, put them in a position to use those abilities in the game. That's what we have to do. So,
how do you balance kind of evaluating talent and trying to morph your system around what you have?
How do you balance evaluating with putting a system in, you know, and coaching football? I think that I actually believe that teaching and developing initially is the most important part of what we've got to do. We got to take this group and coach it. Now, as we go, we'll learn. We'll learn, you know, what to do. We always have a foundation of what we're going to do. So we can go out there and run shingle, a pass pattern that we had. We'll run that wherever we are, whatever we do. It's just very simple play, and it's always in. So in doing that, we'll get a little bit better idea, I think, of what guys can do, and then we'll go from there. We also have a little, you know, like I would, you know, I think a guy, I can look at the film from a year ago, I can watch him in the off-season program and say, with a guy like DeMornay, you know, we can run the fly sweep with them, we can run our wide receiver screens, we can run our reverses with them, and we can run the post. You know, and then we got to teach him a comeback to the field, and that's a pretty good package for a guy. You know, so a little bit of what we're teaching, we got a little bit of an idea already. We have to just do that with more players. Well, I think that Tommy certainly has proven, and, you know, my experience with him is watching a little bit of practice during bowl, watching the bowl game, which I thought was impressive. And, you know, we have had, in our system, you know, that's a loose term a little bit, because our system varied from Derek Anderson to what Lyle Moivau did, right? Lyle was a heck of a quarterback, but he didn't have that same reach on the throws that Derek did or that Mannion did but what he did, he was also, we have these patterns that include these deep angles. Lyle was probably the best angle thrower that we've ever had, you know, so that was more of a featured thing for him. And as you would adapt, like we will as we watch Tommy. Now we're going to put our stuff in and see the the throws that he can make within what we do, and then we have to adapt. And everything I've seen, we're gonna just go with it, you know. And then we're gonna. The other part of it is we won't do. I think we have to be real careful about how much we do right now. So we're not gonna do that. And we are gonna add a little bit more of some stuff that we haven't done, because like I've mentioned before, we've never really had an athlete like Tommy. So a little bit of quarterback run and the things that we can do in that part of it, even with all the other guys, it looks like to me at quarterback here, that's a really good weapon to have. That is a, you know, if you watch teams that are, you look at who has been really, really good third down conversion teams, you just look at the stats, and then you look like, you know, I've seen teams be at 50%, and you know, I'm going to study them in the off season and see what are they doing on third down to be so efficient. Be plus 50% is really good. Well, invariably, the quarterback's running on a lot of those third and mediums. Either he's going to pull the ball down off a pass and go get it. That was Andrew Luck when he first started going. You know, they had a great third down percentage. A lot of the time, he's just making a play. So that versatility is big, or designated quarterback runs, because when you run the ball with the quarterback, you basically have to block one less guy. I mean, it's that's why the spread offense is so hard. It isolates people, makes it hard, and the quarterback as a weapon running the ball, instead of just turning and always handing it off and then being a non-factor, basically, it's a real threat and can be very important on third down. So we're also going to be excited about looking as to what we might add in the offense with guys like play quarterback here right now. I think it's kind of fun.
In watching the film on Tommy and seeing his arm strength, who would you compare it to when you coached
him? I think Lyle, probably, yeah. And I think he's got quick arm. One of the things I first look at a quarterback is how natural he is. Just kind of, you know, the natural rhythm of throwing the ball and a relatively quick release, and it just looks comfortable for him. And I think Tommy's very natural throwing, and I thought Lyle Moivau was one of the most natural guys that we ever had, you know. And we had some good guys, and they all had a little bit. Quarterbacks all have a little bit different motion, but.
Hey, Mike, how much has this last month since recruiting finished given you and your staff the opportunity to start to develop some relationships with these guys, spend more time with them, and what kind of a priority is that through the spring?
How much time have we had since signing date to be able to kind of start a, you know, the normal relationship between coaches and players is the question. And that's a good one. I think for our assistant coaches, I think that they have used this time well in getting to know these players, know their position, know more than that on the team. I think it's been really good. I think the one that's behind on all that is me. You know, I don't like this feeling right now. You know, I walk by most of the team, don't know their name yet. So that's a strange thing for me. But it will pass as we go. I think spring practice will help. But I think that is, you know, in a transition deal. And, you know, because I not only was gone a lot during recruiting, I was gone after that doing some speaking stuff. So I missed. At one point, I think I'd had the job for 75 days and been in Lincoln for 30. So I'm here for a stretch now, so I got a shot. What's your name again?
What kind of attitude do you want to see players start?
Well, I think that, you know, the one thing we have to establish is the team that's going to play hard. So an attitude of, we want to out, and these are very simple things, so this is not rocket science. But I think that the investment leads to the effort. And So we want to put a lot in, and then we want to play hard, and we want to play harder than the other guys. So we got to prepare to do that and then practice like that. So the effort and practice is a big deal. The other thing is we want an attitude of learning, because we want the combination of playing hard and smarter than the other guys too. We got to be, and so you do that through, again, being invested in the game, learning about what you're doing, learning your adjustments, and just being very, very sound. And then it's this should be the time. This should be fun, but it's got to have an element of, you know, focus too. This is not a time for messing around. I'm not a big fan at all of a bunch of trash talking, or, you know, I think that you practice self-control just like you practice how to run the drive play. And so those are all elements that we will reinforce as to what it should look like in practice.
All right, we'll let the coaches out here.
Good to see you guys.